like to thank you, Lord, for the blessings that you've given to us. Just to be able to praise your name one more day. And we thank you for it, Lord. Lord, we thank you for those that are sick in their bed, Lord. Lord, we pray that you give them the strength to scream out hallelujah, the highest praise on earth, in the world, in the universe. And for that, we thank you, Lord. Lord, we bless you just to speak your name, Lord. Lord, we thank you so much for the honor that you have for us, Lord, for just being there by our side, Lord. Just being able to call you friend, Lord. Lord, we thank you for it, Lord. Lord, we thank you for just walking with our families, Lord. Keeping them, Lord. Giving them peace of mind, Lord. In times like these, Lord. For we know that you're coming back soon, Lord, but until then, we're going to keep on praising you. We're going to keep on magnifying you, lifting you up, worshiping you, Lord. And with these blessings and these prayers, Lord, that we have for you, Lord, we understand that there's nobody like you, Lord. And it's in your Son's Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'd like to welcome you to another day, another day's journey, worshiping the Lord. And before we start, we have somebody special out there. And let me, I always like to do this. I always like to tell everybody, hey, this is what we do at Burning Bush Worship Center. We like to celebrate our members' birthday on Sunday with the serenation of a song. Today, we have a special lady that has a birthday on today. Her name is Darvine Jordan. Darvine, that's my cousin's wife, Brittany. We'd like to say happy birthday to you, and we'd like to wish you many more. Get ready.
Happy birthday. 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me.
Oh, So this is personal right here for me.
All right.
Order my steps in your word.
My voice was gone. I prayed and asked him, Lord, if it be your will, not my will, Lord, but your will be done. Whew, my God. My God is an answering God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. He's an answering God.
Yes, he is.
Nobody knows no better than I do.
Yeah.
But I know each one of us have a story.
Yeah.
Thank you, God. I just say thank you, God.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
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 If you have your Bible, will you open your Bible with me to the book of Micah, chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. And it's not one of our normal books, so we're going to give you a little time to look in the table of contents and find out where Micah is. It's in the Old Testament. You find yourself way over there by Revelation, you're in the wrong direction, all right? Amen. Micah, chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. And when you found it, do you mind resting on your feet to give reverence to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? Micah, M-I-C-A-H. Therefore, I will look unto the Lord. I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. Rejoice not against me, O mine enemy. When I fall, I shall rise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord shall be a light unto me. I'd like to use for a thought this morning, and it's in the form of a question. What do you do when you've hit rock bottom? Let us pray. Father, we rejoice in you today, because you told us every good and perfect gift comes from you. And each of us who are breathing in and out have received a perfect gift, and it only came from you. And for that cause, Lord, we thank you.
Thank you.
Lord, we ask that your word will come alive in us, through us, and around us. Have your way today, Lord. Move by your power. Move by your might. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We lift you up. And we pray this prayer in the mighty, matchless name of Jesus. God's people say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. What do you do when you hit rock bottom? The term hitting rock bottom has become prevalent during the times of dealing with persons with addictions. And it's a term that says that you are as low as you can go. You can't, things can't get any worse than they are when you hit rock bottom. When you hit rock bottom, you have come to the realization, you have said to yourself that no, I'll never do this to somebody. I'll never cheat. I'll never steal. But when you hit rock bottom, you've done all those things that you said you wouldn't do. You are in such a bad place that it seems like nobody loves you. Nobody cares. And there was a blues song that said, don't nobody love me but my mama. And she could be jiving too. And that's a place where you have really, really hit rock bottom, when mama says, I'm done with you. I've done all I can do. I've given you all my money. You've stolen it from me. You have said you were going to do this. You said you were going to do that. But because of that problem that you have, you find yourself doing it every time. And the song was just sung, all I do is hurt me. All I do is destroy myself. All I'm doing is killing me and killing everybody around me. That's when you hit rock bottom. The prophet Micah finds himself in a similar situation, but the addiction with the children of Israel is not drugs or alcohol. Their addiction was sin. And Micah found himself in a place where he said, in the beginning of Micah chapter 7, he said, I'm overwhelmed with sorrow, sunk in a deep swamp of despair. I'm like someone who goes into the garden to pick cabbages and carrots and corn and returns empty-handed, finding nothing for soup or sandwich or salad. There's not a decent person in sight. Now, Micah finds himself in a country where it seems like everybody's wicked. Everybody has turned their backs on God. Does that sound familiar? Does it sound like the nation that we live in? And then it says, right, living humans are extinct. They are all out for one another's blood, animals preying on each other. They've all become experts in evil. Now that's a bad place to be living in when evil has become the way of the day. Evil has become so prevalent that people have become experts in evil. Listen to this. Corrupt leaders demand bribes. The powerful rich make sure they get what they want. The best and brightest officials. The top of the line is crabgrass. And then he says, but no longer. Micah is saying, now something's getting ready to cap off. Something is getting ready to happen, because this nation is in a rock bottom state. And Michael said, something's getting ready to happen. Michael says, it is examination time. Something's getting ready to happen in this nation, and God is saying, enough is enough. It's examination time. Then it says, look at them slinking away in disgrace. Then it says, it's so bad that you don't even trust your neighbor. You don't even confide in a friend. You have to watch your words, even with your spouse. Neighbors and families are falling to pieces. Woo! Does that sound familiar? This was way, way back before the captivity of Babylon. Mama against daughter. Son against daddy. Husband against wife. Sister against brother. Sister against sister. All this is going on right now. And God is saying, it's examination time. It's time to take the test. And the whole world is falling to pieces. And God is getting ready to examine each and every one of us. And then it says, the closer they are, sons and daughters and in-laws, the worse they can be. In other words, the closer you get, the worse you are with the person. The closer you get, the more this season has been the worst time that I can recall in my ministry. That every single day there's war. There's a war going on in families. There's wars going on in the job. There's wars going on everywhere. Not just regular wars, but I'm talking about individual wars that's going on. And God says it's testing time. But the thing that blows my mind, even though man in this day and age is totally corrupt, the children of God, I'm not talking about the unsaved. I'm talking about saved folk. Talking about saved folk now are doing corrupt things, and Micah says, in the midst of all of this, He says, but I'm not giving up. I'm sticking around to see what God will do. I'm waiting for God to make things right. And so what Micah is saying, you know what Micah's name means? Who is like the Lord? That's what Micah means. Who is? You know, we say this, who is like the Lord? Nobody. And Micah is saying, even in the midst, even though he's a prophet, he's speaking for the nation. He is saying that I'm in the midst of this. Some of you might be living for God right now, but because of your surroundings, God has placed you in the midst of all of the corruption that's going on, because there has to be some light in the midst of darkness. So God is saying, if you don't mind, Micah, if you don't mind that letting me speak to you, I know it hurts at times to counsel the people and they don't listen to a thing you say, but Micah, hang on in there. Everything's going to be all right. Micah says, I'm counting on God to listen to me. And what do you do when you hit rock bottom? You're going to have to do the very thing that Micah says, I'm not giving up. Even though I messed up, and you remember we talking about it, even though I get drunk as Cooney Brown, I ain't giving up. I ain't quitting. See, a lot of us have a tendency to think because you messed up. And who has not messed up, Roy? Is anybody in the house, outside the house or anywhere that's listening to my voice, is there anybody in the house that has hit rock bottom because of what you did? I ain't talking about what somebody else did. I'm talking about what I did. I've been hit as low as I can go, not because of the white man or the blue man or the green man, but because of the black man, Willie. Caused myself to hit rock bottom. But I heard in the word of God, yeah, it says, if I confess my sin before him, he is faithful and he is just to forgive me of that sin and to do what? To cleanse me,
yeah,
from all unrighteousness. And even though you have messed up, God said, I'm setting this day aside for those who are jacked up. I'm set this day aside for those who do what I say and act the way they're supposed to act. So they think. I want to talk to that person who has gone above and beyond the call of sin. But you have. But you know me by my name. God is saying to you, yeah, you're going to go through, but you're coming out of this thing. Trouble don't last always. And I heard Paul says I ain't talking about the good folk. I'm talking about the bad saved folk. Paul says in his word, you are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus, our Lord. So what Paul has said, yeah, you messed up, but even though you messed up, you're still more than a conqueror. Even though you're in the pit, even though you have hit rock bottom, I am going to pull you up out of that situation in due season. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy's coming in the morning. You're coming out of this thing. Because of Jesus' resurrection, all threats against you are tamed. Death and evil, they're not the end of your story. You look all the way through scripture. You see, Peter messed up.
and Peter even what denied Jesus. You can't get any. And it said that when the cock crowed and Jesus looked at Peter, Peter walked away and cried. Peter was in a rock bottom situation. He was in such a state. No, and then he said one time, I'll never deny you. And a lot of times when we are in our right mind, we would never think that we would do the things that we do, but when we get caught up in sin, we do just like Peter did. Start cussing. Say you don't know me. But Jesus, when he was came out of the grave, he said, go find the disciples. And he said, and Peter too. So what Jesus was saying, yeah, he denied me, but I still got a plan for you. Yeah, you messed up, but God still got a plan for you. Micah is saying to you, in your state, who is like the Lord? Yeah, mama might not forgive you, daddy might not forgive you, I might not forgive you, but who is like the Lord? Nobody. God is saying in his word, you are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Anybody messed up? And still believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sin? If you believe that and believe that God has raised Jesus Christ, our Lord, from the dead, you got a chance. You're going to make it. Let me read some of the scriptures to let you know that you're going to be all right, because Jesus keeps saying, he that overcomes, he that overcomes, he that overcomes. Yeah, I fell up, but I'm an overcomer too. In Revelation 2 and 7, it says that he that hath an ear, listen to me now, you don't have to hear me now. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To, listen to this, to him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. He that hath an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, save he that receiveth it. And to him that overcometh and keep my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nation. To him that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my God and before his angels. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more, and I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. I will write upon him a new name. And God is trying to encourage, trying to say to you, trying to say to me, don't give up. Don't quit. I'm going to spank you. I'm going to take you to the woodshed. Yeah, you messed up, but I chasten those whom I love. I'm not beating you because you are bad. I'm beating you because I love you. Amen. I'm whipping you into subjection unto my will, unto my way. I'm telling you, how many, you know, when
my children were growing up, they couldn't understand why all the kids in the neighborhood wanted to stay at my house. And my son Aaron said, why y'all want to go to my house? You know my daddy gonna beat you? And everybody in the neighborhood, when they come over to my house, you're gonna do what I tell you. But they never wanted to go to their house. They can do anything they want. They can get away with anything they want. No, they want to go where they're going to get beat. And that's what the children of God are doing. God said, if you mess up, run to me. Don't run away from me. Run to me. I'm going to wrap my arms around you. I'm going to get you. But then I'm going to put my power to you because I love you. Because I don't want no one to perish. I don't want anyone to perish. I want everyone to come to the knowledge of me. That's what I want. Because I love you so much that I sent my only begotten son to die for you. He who knew no sin became sin.
Yeah.
For us.
Yeah.
Because he loves us just that much. I'd rather go ahead and get a whipping from God to see the kingdom, to never get a beating and live my life in hell. What do? When you hit rock bottom, trust in the Lord.
Hallelujah.
With all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he's going to direct your path. You remember the prodigal son? When he said, I think I'll go back home. And he was trying to concoct all of the noise. I'll scrub floors for him, and I'll do this, and I'll do that, and I'm going to do all these things for you, Lord. But say what I'm going to say to daddy. But my Bible tells me that when daddy saw the prodigal son coming down the road, he didn't turn his back on him. The word said, daddy ran to him. If you messed up, God said, I'll run to you. If you just call on my name, I'll come running to you. And I'll put a new robe on you. I'll put a new ring on you. I'm going to wrap royalty around you again because you my child. And I love you. What do? When you hit rock bottom, realize that if you made your bed, yeah, you're in hell right now. But if you make your bed in hell, God says, I'm there. I'm there.
Yeah.
I'm there. And I will lift you up out of the muck and mire. I will pick you up, turn you around, place your feet on solid ground. And then you know what? The thing about it, when God, those of us, I didn't say those of y'all, those of us who have messed up royally, and our friends come around, you mean to tell me you back in church? All the mess that you did, God says, whenever somebody comes to you and try to bring up your mess, tell them, come talk to my dad. If he let me in, who you think you are, Mr. Big Stuff? Who do you think you are? Are you bigger than God? No. If God forgave you, you ain't got to worry about anybody else. What do when you hit rock bottom? Call on the name of the Lord, because he is the only one that can pull you out of that mess that we've all been in. All have sinned.
Yes.
All, not some, not most, but all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You know, God is blessing Brandon Bush so much, so greatly,
And one person said to me, "Boy, you must be living right." And I said, "For all this to be happening, you must be living." I said, "No, it ain't because I'm living right. It's because I'm believing right." Amen. You see, living right ain't gonna cause God, or living wrong ain't gonna change God one way or the other. But the word says that Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. It doesn't say because Abraham was just as jacked up as we are. Tell him you my sister. Don't tell him you my wife. Tell him you my sister. And that's the biggest lie. But God says, Abraham is the father of faith. Uh-huh. Because he believed God.
Yeah.
He believed God. So I'm telling you, if you messed up, believe God. Believe God. Stand on his word. And say, "Lord, you promised me that if I confess my sin before you, you faithful and just to forgive me." And I'm standing on that word.
Yeah.
I'm standing on it. I'm believing it. Yeah, I messed up. And I know I got to pay for the consequences to my mess, but I'm still believing you to bring me out of it. And God says, "That's my boy. That's my girl." What do you do when you hit rock bottom? Call on the name of the Lord. At this time, we're going to ask Pastor Tim Williams if he will come forward and prepare communion for us.
Afternoon, Bernie Bush. It's again, we come to celebrate another first Sunday. And as again, we ask you to bring your own elements as you prepare, whether it's water and bread or juice and bread or whatever it is that you're about to consecrate before the Lord. We ask you to bring it, prepare it as we come before him to remember what he's asked us to do in remembrance of him. Will y'all stand, please? That evening, he took the bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. As we all eat, let's all eat together." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup and he blessed it and said, "This is my blood shed for you. As often as you do this in remembrance of me. Let us all drink together." And he went out into the night and he sang a hymn. Why don't you just shout glory to God for salvation in Jesus' name? Amen. Amen.